I am going to talk about some things that I have been thinking about recently. So I hope in the discussion period to get some assistance from you in moving forward, or maybe dropping the whole subject. We'll see. I am looking forward to getting some of your perspectives. And what I've been thinking about are parallels in the two areas that I have, in which I've been doing work, as Professor Marchioni just outlined. I've done work in social epistemology of science and also work on the behavioral sciences. And what I've been kind of mulling over is the fact that they both offer examples of analysis at different scales. There can be analysis at the level of individual performance, individual action, and so forth, but also at the level or the scale of communities or populations. And what I have argued, of course, with respect to both of them is that there are certain problems that are both articulable and possibly solvable at the community level that are not soluble by analysis at the individual level. So in thinking about this, well, I find myself a little bit reluctantly, actually very reluctantly, drawn to thinking about metaphysical issues, but I'm going to try to stay away from those as much as I can. I want to talk more about the actual work in the those areas that leads me to these thoughts, and then perhaps at the end make some suggestions, but that's where I hope that you will have some help for me about how to move forward. So, of course, the notion of individualism, like the notion of reductionism, is often a disparaging charge leveled at accounts that one disagrees with. It can mean many things, and it has multiple contrast terms. We'll come back to that later on. So what I'd like to do today is talk about these two contexts in which I have done work, so I apologize for repeating things, but it'll be so broadly sketched that you won't feel you're reading my book again at all. So I want to look at these contexts of philosophical work on knowledge and work on behavior. Think about the ways in which traditional approaches in these fields center the individual, reflect on alternative scales of analysis, and how the same problems are going to be conceived differently at these different scales. And then maybe end with some summary remarks about contrasts, and then some questions. So, where am I? Yes. In traditional epistemology, the individual cognitive agent and his or her doxastic states have been the focus of analysis. S knows that P. Okay, anybody who's taken an epistemology course is very familiar with that phrase, and that phrase as a target of philosophical analysis. So, you know, what does it mean to say that S knows that P? Well, it's attributing the belief that P to some subject S or cognitive agent S. It's saying that S is justified in some way, and of course there's lots of debate about what that justification consists in, justified in that belief, and that the belief is true. So all of these, belief, truth, justification, there's lots and lots of work trying to analyze those constituent concepts of S knows that P. Now, recently in epistemology in the United States, there's been interest in something called social epistemology, thinking about social phenomena, which considers the individual in social relations. So we have Alvin Goldman's title of his major book in this area, Knowledge in a Social World. Well, what does this mean? It means somehow that the individual cognitive agent, whom we've been thinking about in the past as someone who has beliefs that may or may not be justified, but if they're justified, then they're candidates for knowledge, and if they're true, then they're knowledge. The individual cognitive agent finds her or himself among other cognitive agents. And that's generally taken as meaning that the individual cognitive agent has more or different sources of information, different sources of evidence, and some maybe additional occasions for doubt, in addition to the agent's own past failures. So topics in this social epistemology include testimony, trying to understand testimony, what are the conditions under which one should accept testimony, and of course there's lots of observation about the fact that we actually accept many, many of the things we think we know on the basis of testimony. We read the newspapers, we listen to the news, we learn from our teachers, and so forth. So we carry about in our heads lots of things that we did not directly acquire from observation of the world. We carry in our heads many things that we have learned from others. So how do we think about that, this problem of testimony? Disagreement. Right, when we're in the midst of other cognitive agents may assess the same things that we have assessed in a different way. The problem of deference to experts. So the questions are things like, should I believe S when S tells me that the next train to Espoo is at whatever time it is? Should I believe S when S tells me that there's been an earthquake in Italy, as there was, very sadly, just some hours ago? What kinds of safeguards should I employ in accepting the testimony of another? Do I need to sort of ascertain that that person is a regular truth teller, for example? Well, and so on and so on. What should be my attitude or response to disagreement? Should I just ignore it when others disagree with me? Should I pay attention? And what kind of attention should I pay? When is deference to experts warranted? How can I tell if an expert, a so-called expert, is genuine? How do I choose between experts who disagree with one another? The so-called two-expert problem, or novice to expert problem. So all of these involve at least two individuals. If someone disagrees with me, there's another person, the disagreeer, and myself. In the case of testimony, there's I who listen and the testifier, and so on and so forth. But in the literature, they're analyzed from the individual's perspective. They're analyzed from the point of view of I, a cognitive agent, who must somehow assess the testimony of others, cope with the disagreement from others, think about the possible authority of others. Alexander Bird has, I think, rather fetchingly called the kind of epistemology that this work represents individualist social epistemology, or ISE, which he contrasts with a more social epistemology. Okay, so that's, I'm going to come back to epistemology in a moment, but in behavioral science, the focus is also on individual organisms. We can say individuals, and we'll just assume human individuals here. And the approaches that I think about in thinking about this question include such things as quantitative behavior genetics, molecular behavior genetics, neurophysiological behavioral research, social environmental behavioral research, psychological research that looks to features of the individual's developmental environment, for example, and a bunch of integrative approaches. And what these approaches kind of start with is the fact that human and non-human organisms of the same species resemble one another in some ways and differ from one another in some ways. And the question is, what accounts for the different behaviors or different intensity or frequency of behaviors that organisms of the same species exhibit? And as Professor Marchioni said, different research methods permit different questions and hypotheses, or at least that's what I argued. You can disagree, but anyway, that's what I argued in studying human behavior. So, for example, quantitative behavior genetics asks, to what extent can variation in some behavior be dancing, reading, playing music in some population P be attributed to genetic variation, and to what extent is it attributable to environmental variation? Neurophysiologists are going to ask, to what extent can some behavior be, whatever it is, be associated with or attributed to a given neural process N, whatever that is. Social environmentally oriented approaches ask, to what extent can behavior be associated with or attributed to some particular social environmental condition E. Social phenomena, like aggression, right? Aggression is not something I engage in all by myself, standing in the closet with the door closed. No, aggression is something I direct towards another. Sexual behavior, well, some sexual behavior is engaged in on one's own, but generally it involves two or more persons. But the point is that these are studied in the research approaches that I talked about. These are studied as individual traits. So the question might be, what factors impact the disposition to react aggressively to situations? Right? So aggression is thought of as a trait of an individual. Individuals have dispositions to respond aggressively in various circumstances. Or what factors impact the choice of a sexual partner or a sexual activity? Again, the choice is thought of as an individual's choice to do something or other. And what I argued in studying human behavior is that approaches that take individuals and individual differences to be the central object of research are not able to address all the questions one might want to ask. So, how do problems shift their character when they're examined at a different scale? What is the issue? Okay, and this is where I think you can help me. To make some of this more sharp, I'd like to look a little bit more closely at the two areas of inquiry. So, in epistemology, let's just take one of the topics of individualist social epistemology, disagreement. And here the literature I'm talking about involves papers by Thomas Kelly, David Christensen, Adam Elga, Sherry Lynn Rausch, and a few others. So the situation in disagreement is characterized this way. You and your friend, whom you consider to be your epistemic peer, you know, sometimes the situation is described as you and your friend who is your epistemic peer, but will stay with whom you consider. Obviously, there are difficulties. Somebody may be your epistemic peer without your knowing it, and so you'll react quite differently. Whom you consider to be your epistemic peer are in possession of the same evidence but come to different conclusions on the basis of that evidence. What is it to be an epistemic peer? Well, it's to be someone who has roughly the same sensory equipment as you do, the same, roughly the same perceptive powers as you do, and the same reasoning powers as you do, roughly the same calculative powers as you do. And we know we all differ from one another in these, so to be a peer is to have, you know, roughly the same. One of the classic examples in this literature is, and of course this really doesn't apply in Finland, but oh well. So it just shows the North American bias of this this discussion. Calculating a tip, right? So in the United States, because we don't pay people well enough, we add a gratuity or a tip when we're receiving a service. And the percentage is whatever it is. But that's what we do. When we've had a meal together and we're calculating how much we have to leave, we take into account the tip. So the two of us, or three of us, or however many, but two of us are calculating what the final bill is going to be. We both see the bill in front of us, which has calculated the tax, but not the tip. Although now restaurants are actually doing that for you, and they will tell you, if you want to leave 15%, leave this. If you want 18%, so on. It's not trusting the mathematical abilities of their clients, I don't know. Or maybe just upping the ante a bit. Anyway, this has not been done in this case, in this restaurant, for the purposes of this example. So we have the same amounts in front of us, the same basic amounts. We both use the same percentage in our calculation, but we propose different sums. Okay? And the examples, if those of you who know the literature know that one of them, I propose $43, and you, my friend, propose $45. So what am I, who proposed $43, supposed to think? Now, what am I supposed to do? What are some other examples? Again, just thinking about these papers, judging, really predicting the outcome of a horse race, or we could even say judging the outcome of a horse race, if we try to see, you know, which horse passed the finish line first. That's why we have photo finish these days, but without photo finish, judging the outcome of a horse race. There's one kind of example. Another kind of example, which is obviously a very different kind of example, we disagree about the effectiveness or the effects of having a death penalty. Has the institution of the death penalty reduced crime in location L? Contrasting weather forecasts on the basis of the same meteorological information. Meteorologist M predicts that there is a 30% chance of rain, and meteorologist M2 predicts that there is an 80% chance of rain. Another example is intended to bring out a contrast between two different kinds of thing about which one might disagree. What's the product of 5,243,324 multiplied by 922. Now, for most of us, we think that there is a determinate correct answer to that question. But we can also see how easy it would be to make an error. Okay? It's not a simple matter to make this calculation. We need most of us, except for the savants, need paper and pencil, and we're going to work out the multiplication. But still, there's a correct answer. And so if you disagree with me about the total, I can think, well, I must have made a mistake somewhere, or you made a mistake somewhere. But there's a correct answer. And that's contrasted with beliefs like the belief about the effectiveness of the death penalty, but even more complicated, contesting views about the morality of abortion, for example, where there isn't a simple correct answer. And in fact, views about the morality of abortion are tied up with all kinds of other views about different kinds of facts that are relevant to this discussion, different values. So it's not a simple kind of yes or no answer. So again, that's another example that gets discussed. Well, in the face of any of these disagreements, the issue is, what should you do, or what should I do? Should I hold fast to my original conclusion? Or should I adjust my belief in the direction of yours? And sometimes this is discussed in terms of sort of categorical belief. Sometimes it's discussed in terms of credences. I'm glossing over those subtleties. If you hold fast to your original conclusion, disregarding the fact of disagreement, are you being unreasonable? Are you depriving yourself of possible additional sources of reasons for or against your belief? Or are you depriving yourself of access to reasons that are relevant to maintaining a kind of healthy doxastic situation? If you adjust your belief in the direction of your friends, do you thereby undermine your own self-trust, ending up, if we follow the iteration long enough, in being unable to believe anything? Are you spineless? Okay, so this is the kind of problem, and this is the way the problem of disagreement is represented. Right? So that's what I'm trying to emphasize here, how the problem even gets represented as something to address. And the philosophical issues that get discussed turn out to be involve like things like clarifying what kind of evidence the fact that some other, an epistemic peer, believes not P constitute relative to my belief that P. So is the fact that another believes not P where I believe P itself evidence that not P, where that other is an epistemic peer, so is as likely to have a correct belief as I am? Or is it one more factor to add to my original body of evidence relative to P? Okay, so this is I'm just trying to give you a sense of what the kinds of questions are that are discussed in this literature. Another is to clarify the conditions. So this is a lot of the discussion involves clarifying the conditions in which it is reasonable to hold fast. And that would be when there's reason to think that the other has made some mistake or been otherwise compromised in this instance. So, for example, the other may have a kind of bias about a particular phenomenon, say the the academic abilities of her or his child. Right. So it's likely that one has a bias in favor of those. That might be where they might be perceived differently by someone else, whether the parent of another child or a teacher or so on. Okay, so when is it reasonable to hold fast? When there's reason to think that the other has made some mistake, maybe they're likely to make mistakes about some matters, or been otherwise compromised, as in the case of bias. And those conditions in which it's reasonable to adjust one's belief or level of credence. So the one proposal is that when the explanation of our disagreement is achieved in a way that's independent of my reasoning on the matter in dispute, and secondly, provides reason to believe that the explanation in terms of my error is as good as explanations in terms of the other's error. So in those cases, it's reasonable to adjust. Okay, so most of the discussants in the literature come to relatively intuitively acceptable and relatively close conclusions about the conditions for holding fast, adjusting, splitting the difference, granting equal weight, and so forth. The difference is in how they come to those conclusions, so that disagreement, the philosophical fact of disagreement, is treated as an occasion to think about standard epistemological questions about belief, justification, and reasons in a slightly new context. Right, so it's, you know, how to apply Bayesian methodology to this treatment, for example. How do our thoughts about evidence and levels of evidence, second order evidence, and so forth, play a role in this discussion? So the problem of disagreement is conceived from within a single point of view. It's either I or you faced with someone who disagrees with me or with you. And the question is what I or you should do in the face of disagreement. The other party only appears as the provider of disagreement, and sometimes is represented as remaining intransigent, just to add a little bit more to the discussion, to show, for example, how the conciliatory or equal weight view ends up undermining itself after sufficient iterations. But the other party just disagrees. That's all. And there's an interesting presupposition to the problem as well, namely that if two individuals are privy to the same evidence, E, that's relevant to the truth or falsity of some proposition P, and have the same reasoning capacities, they should come to the same conclusion about P. Any different outcome is unusual and an exception, and as unusual and an exception, it requires special treatment, that is, the treatment of the philosophical problem of disagreement. Okay, so if we move to philosophy of science, it's true that philosophy of science did once treat the cognitive aspects of science as basically tractable from within the perspective of traditional epistemology, as subject to the standard epistemological norms, but simply more stringently understood. Science was characterized by really careful measurement, not just casual observation. It was characterized by mathematically rigorous reasoning and not just common garden variety rationality. But scientific knowledge was regarded as the cumulative aggregation of the results of individual cognitive activity. But history of science and empirical observation of science, especially as that continued to be done from the middle of the 20th century on, brought to our attention that in the sciences, it's pretty common that two or more individuals would be privy to the same data relevant to propositions in some domain of inquiry and come to different conclusions. So already one might see a contrast with the disagreement literature from the perspective of ISE, or individualist social epistemology, where the tone of that literature is that we as cognitive agents have a very well enough developed a sense of reasons, evidence, and so forth. We have developed our own capacities for epistemic evaluation, but then suddenly encounter disagreement and are puzzled and need some strategy to deal with that fact. That actually, I think, fits better the history of the philosopher thinking about knowledge rather than the individual cognitive agent. But never mind, that's the tone, interesting tone of the literature. Whereas in science, I think, or thinking about science, we just don't take that view. So I think it's we've come to accept after Kuhn and after the sociologists of science, that it's not uncommon, it's pretty common to see that individuals can vary in their assessment of the same evidence. Well, how could this be? There were different accounts of this. Kuhn, Hansen, and Feyerabend argued for theory-laden observation, so that observation is never simple and is never independent of the body of theory that one brings to one's observational tasks. And there are various ways of thinking about the ways in which theory is infuses observation. Another way of thinking about this is provided by Pierre Duhem with his account of underdetermination. Both theory-ladenness and underdetermination expand the cognitive situation. There's what's salient at the level of individual cognizers, data and hypothesis, yes, observational and rational power, yes, but also either assumptions or paradigms or theories that determine and influence the evidential relevance of observable data to hypotheses. My own preference between these two strategies is the Duhemian. And here's a quote from Duhem's 1906. This is from the 1956 English language edition. In order to deduce from this proposition the hypothesis, from this proposition, which is the hypothesis under consideration, the prediction of a phenomenon and institute the experiment which is to show whether this phenomenon is or is not produced, the physicist does not confine himself or herself to making use of the proposition in question. He makes use also of a whole group of theories accepted by him as beyond dispute. So underdetermination, so there isn't any direct relationship between the hypothesis, the theoretical model or whatever that's under consideration, and the data that are going to be relevant to assessing, the observational data, experimental data that are going to be relevant to assessing that hypothesis. So underdetermination, as I've talked about it, concerns what I call the semantic gap between descriptions of single observations or of sets of observation that serve as data and the hypotheses the data are taken to support when these are categorically articulated. So for some classic examples, we can think about the difference in content, difference in semantic content, between a description of patterns of tracks in cloud chambers and claims about the behavior of elementary particles. Right? What we see in cloud chambers are not elementary particles. We see their tracks, and we infer from the tracks various properties of elementary particles and their interactions. Or the difference in content between reports of patterns of hemoglobin oxygenation and deoxygenation in brain tissue as measured by magnetic resonance imaging, and claims about specific brain activity or specific mind activity. So thinking about these examples, which you know are common, kinds of examples which are common, lead me to say that, along with Duhem, that assumptions have to mediate the relation between data and hypotheses. That is, it's assumptions that establish the evidential relevance of data. But that means that there are some problems. If assumptions fix evidential relevance, then we need to evaluate the assumptions that facilitate that fixing. How is the choice of assumption not arbitrary if it's not itself data-driven? And does the necessity for such assumptions undermine the philosopher's claim for objectivity and rationality? Of course, my solution was that we move to the social level and that we move to think about scientific inquiry as a social phenomenon that involves critical interaction among inquirers. So underdetermination is not fully eliminated, But reliance on background assumptions that establish evidential relevance is legitimated by their having been subject to critical scrutiny under certain conditions. And so I've tried to talk about conditions in a community that facilitate transformative criticism in the view of critical contextual empiricism. So the point is, or a point, is that social here means interactive and not shared. So the idea, to talk about science as a social inquiry, or scientific inquiry as a social phenomenon, is to say that it involves interaction, not that the important thing to think about is the ways in which assumptions, paradigms, theories, and so forth are shared, but the ways in which they're subjected to critical examination in discursive interaction among members of a scientific community. And of course, from this point of view, from this kind of more social point of view, other features of science, features other than careful measurement, mathematical reasoning, become salient. So we need to think about the role of communication, journals, conferences, peer review, and there's starting to be some interesting work on peer review now. The informal exchange of materials and of students, for example. We think about the intergenerational transfer of knowledge, the division of cognitive labor, issues of repeatability, replication, and so on, all geared towards the publicity of scientific knowledge. We think about the institutions that support scientific research, universities, private and government funding agencies, and research institutes, professional associations. And the question, of course, here is how any of these, or how all of these, facilitate or inhibit the development of knowledge, understanding that, in fact, they do, and the question is how. So on this view, scientific knowledge is the outcome of the interactions among multiple individuals, and not just the sum or aggregative total of their individual independent contributions. And so disagreement is not a problem. Disagreement, from this point of view, is a necessity, as it is the fuel of critical interaction. I'm not going to engage in, critical interaction takes, gets going when somebody says, "I don't think so." And then you have to say why you think so, that person has to say why they don't think so, et cetera. So here, the response to disagreement isn't independent recalibration of one's beliefs or credences, but rather engagement in discursive interaction. So from the perspective of the community scale, we just think of disagreement and response to disagreement in a very different way. So there are a couple of more differences with individualist social epistemology. On this view, inquiry and knowledge are conceived of as dynamic, or they can be conceived of as dynamic. They change in response to criticism. Criticism is an ongoing process. There's criticism, new findings, new interests, and so forth. So disagreement is just part of this ongoing dynamic rather than the kind of static situation as it's represented in individualist social epistemology. And as I said earlier, the building blocks of knowledge are not the outcome of individual action. They're not the outcome of individual experiments performed in the glorious solitude of one's laboratory and the reasoning that one engages in about those experiments. So it's not the simple collection of all the articles that have been published in science journals. Publication in a science journal is just the beginning of a process of public critical assessment, some of which has already taken place through the process of peer review, but this is just moves to a different level. So the building blocks are not the outcome of, well, they're not individual action, but interactions. And thirdly, if we think about the other topics in individual social epistemology, they present somewhat differently as well. The pervasive reliance on the experiments and observations of others and the multiply variable factors that go into the design and interpretation of experiments makes trust and trustworthiness something like the basic moral glue that binds a community rather than something that has to be ascertained before you actually accept the testimony of another. Here, Torsten Vilholt has done some interesting work arguing that it's simply not possible to engage in the kind of investigation that's assumed in the ISE discussion of testimony in the context of the sciences. And the question about expertise, we can also start to see differently, not as a question about when to defer to experts, but as a question about how the status of expert is actually bestowed. Who becomes an expert? How? What might the responsibilities as well as privileges be that attach to the status of expertise? So we can think about experts quite differently and testimony quite differently. Okay, so much for the epistemological questions. If we move to the behavioral sciences, as I said, that gets started by noticing that individuals vary in their expression of different behaviors. Some individuals read more than the average person, some read less, some eat meat, some don't, some marry, some, here we're talking about humans, some marry, some don't, some finish university, some don't, some are energetic, some are quiet, some are quarrelsome, some are not, some who marry later divorce, some who marry do not divorce, some dance, some don't, some play music. I mean, you know, we can go on and on and on. There's a long list of the kinds of things we do that we vary from one another on. When these are options in a population, the question is why people fall into one or the other of these categories or fall into a particular position on a spectrum-like or multiply valued quantitative trait. And the behavioral sciences seek to answer this question. Even when the research methodology permits only correlations among behaviors and studied factors, it's intended ultimately to contribute to an understanding of the causes of behavior. So we can say about the various methodologies, well, this only gives us a correlation. That's true, but we're only interested in the correlation insofar as it's a step towards understanding causation. But to ask about the causal influences on the expression of a trait in a population is already to be committed to an individualist point of view. And that's true even when the methodology, as quantitative behavior genetics does, permits only an apparently non-individualist expression of the problem and answers. The issue is, the question is about traits expressed by individuals in a population. And the sciences that I listed earlier seek to understand factors that impact on the internal or psychic, internal psychic or physical structure of individuals that leads them to develop dispositions to behave in particular ways. And that extends to social behaviors as well, like aggression or sexual behavior. The ontology stays the same. So the question is, why some individuals are more aggressive than the average for a population, or why some individuals seek partners of the same sex or of different sex in a population, or other questions about the individual participants in these social activities and other kinds of social activities. And as in traditional epistemology, I think that there are questions that can't be answered by the traditional methodologies if we move to a different scale of question, If we're thinking about variation among populations, as distinct from variation among individuals in a population. So for example, if our question is, why are crime rates in country Y different from crime rates in country X? Or why are recidivism rates in neighborhood N1 higher or lower than those in neighborhood N2? Research on individual differences within a population is not going to provide answers to that question. Research on individual differences in the population would attribute the difference to features of the individuals. Right. Well, why do I think that? So the contrast that I'm thinking about is represented here. We can think about population level variation, the difference between population 1 and population 2, or neighborhood 1 and neighborhood 2, either as the aggregate effect of individual dispositions, that is, the dispositions of the individuals constituting the populations, where then we're going to look to genetic research, neurophysiological research, research on family environment, et cetera. We can also, instead of looking at that, look at population level variation among populations, where we're going to look at factors like variations in the, or differences in the physical environment. For example, the resource base may be shrinking or expanding. The climate may be changing in one direction or another. That's what lots of people are experiencing now. We can look to features of social structure, variation in distribution of wealth, variation in distribution of labor, of resource access, variations in age structure. Okay, so this is a two very different kinds of approaches to thinking about variation among populations as opposed to variation among individuals. Success of the aggregative approach would require, it seems to me, that distribution of the causal factors that affect individual traits, genes, school, family environment, neural structures, and so on, would have to vary in parallel with the behavioral distributions, the different behavioral distributions in the different populations. So as an example of why I think that doesn't work, I'll just mention this one study by Ely, Lichtenstein, and Stevenson that was done as a study of trying to understand whether there was a sex difference in the heritability of aggression. Okay, there's accepted to be a sex difference in the expression of aggression, but this was the heritability of aggression that was using data from the United Kingdom and Sweden. So they found no sex difference in heritability. Aggressive behavior, however that was measured, was heritable to the same degree in girls and boys. But there was one feature of this data which the researchers noted, but they didn't attempt to explain or discuss or accommodate in their models, and that was a difference in the frequency of aggressive behavior between the two national cohorts. Right? So they said, oh, that's interesting, yes, we saw that. And the British population showed a higher frequency of interpersonal violence than the Swedish one. Okay, well, in an aggregative approach, the Swedish and British populations would have to differ genetically, neurally, or with respect to patterns of child rearing in a way that tracks the different frequencies of interpersonal violence in those two populations. Right? But it just seems to me not credible that two Northern European populations would differ systematically enough in those factors, genetics, neurophysiological structures, to support a methodologically individualist or aggregative explanation of the behavioral difference between the two populations. So I want to suggest that the difference between the two countries can't be treated simply as the summation of the effects of factors that explain why individuals within each population would differ from each other. And instead, we would need to look to population level differences like features of a physical resource base or other physical features, or features of social structure, such as variation in distribution of wealth, access to resources, and so forth. Okay, so much for that. So thinking about this, one of the things that's interesting to me is that at the population scale, we can really depersonalize. We can think not about individuals who are bad or good, aggressive or non-aggressive. When we're thinking about so-called social behavior, what we're really thinking about and what we can count are social interactions, right? Not numbers of individuals who express aggressive behavior, but rather aggressive interactions that involve aggression. So we don't need to think about individual traits or behaviors at all. Now, this focus on interaction is permissive in contrast to what I claim about the epistemology of science, where I think interaction is a required aspect of the what's a required aspect of the analysis that I give, let's say. But it does permit different research questions. Because the phenomena to investigate, the phenomena of interest, are much less individual differences in behaviors in a population, but the phenomena that become of interest are changes in the relative frequencies of interaction types over time, so through history. And here we're going to talk again about these population level variation and other things that varies across time in different forms of community, urban and rural, for example, in different societies, Norway versus France, or Sweden versus the UK, Finland versus Denmark. Different kinds of societies, agricultural economies versus industrialized economies. Going along with this focus on interaction, we can rethink the behaviors that are treated as individual traits in the behavioral research that I was talking about as interactions, and be measuring not individual movement or individual action, but be measuring interactions like arrests. Okay, arrest involves an arrestor and an arrestee, right? And they interact. Someone puts the cuffs on you or whatever. Rearrests, that would be recidivism. Assault, reports of assault and assault, incidents of fighting. Fighting involves, you know, fighting doesn't happen in the closet. I mean, there's some individual struggle, of course, we know that. But fighting is something that takes place between two or more people. Violent quarrels. Quarrels require at least two people. And we can think about sex in the same way. Sex is not, we can give a study, not the individual's inclination towards some sexual behavior, but we can, you know, think about as objects of measurement the sexual interactions themselves. Different kinds, same-sex coupling, heterosex coupling, couplings in context of committed relationships, one-time casual couplings, serial monogamous. Humans do all kinds of stuff. So those of us who teach know that our students are doing all kinds of stuff that we didn't think about when we were students. Celibacy, which is a kind of renunciation of certain kinds of interaction. Onanism, which, I would argue that's a kind of interaction with oneself, but enough of that. What are some of the differences between the population level analysis and individual level analysis? Well, okay, so we can count interactions as interactions, right? rather than as individual actions or behavior. And we'll probably get different measurements when we do that. We can focus on interaction rather than the states or conditions that allow for a different characterization of the participants in an interaction. The dependence on multiple kinds of factor, all of which may change, makes population a changing, population variation also a changing rather than a static phenomenon. And it makes interaction part of the domain under investigation rather than featuring in postulated explanations. So we may be familiar, especially in thinking about behavioral science, in work that tries to talk about the interaction between genes and environment, for example. That's where interaction and, you know, there are issues of whether we're talking about statistical interaction, physical interaction, and so forth, but there interaction is part of a postulated explanation of a measured phenomena. Here, interaction is part of the phenomena that are being explained. It's part of the domain about which we're trying to understand something. So in both the epistemology and in behavioral science, changing scale makes salient different objects of measurement. And in both cases, the salience of interaction makes events rather than entities the focus of investigation. So I think there's something interesting to think about there. And it facilitates a dynamic rather than a static conception of the phenomena that we're trying to explain. Rejecting individualism can be done on the basis of at least two contrasts. We can be thinking about the contrast between an individual entity and a group or collective entity, where a group or collective entity is constituted or made up of, or Brian Epstein will explain this all tomorrow, individuals. Or another contrast, and this is the contrast I've been trying to talk about, is a contrast between individual movement or action as opposed to interactive movement. So what I want help thinking about is this this second. So what are the ontological or metaphysical issues that are raised? I mean, some we can think about. How does interaction differ from action in a social, how does interaction differ from action? How does interaction differ from social relation? Where was I looking? Someplace online, probably Wikipedia. I looked up interaction and social interaction and social relation are defined together. So social interaction or social relation, as though they're the same thing. Well, I'm not so sure. I can be next to you, that's a relation, but that's not an interaction. Okay, so there are some obvious questions to ask about interaction. I think that there are some not so obvious questions also to be asked about interaction. But I get the feeling that interaction has been understudied philosophically. We've got tons of work in philosophy of action, but I don't think we have as much work on interaction. And a quick perusal of a couple of sources. Field papers, for example, revealed that there's thinking about interaction in the context of cognitive science, which is kind of interesting. List of articles, most of which that came out in cognitive science journals. There was a special issue of Synthèse on interactivism as a facet of general process theory. So there is discussion of interaction in certain contexts of discussions of metaphysics, about which I've already told you I'm a little nervous. I'm just a philosopher of science, and metaphysics is not really my area, although I realize that in trying to think about interaction, I'm treading dangerously close. Now, other sources in social sciences did better, but the Oxford Dictionary of Social Science had under the heading interaction, see symbolic interactionism. Well, I know about symbolic interactionism, but I was hoping there would be more. And some of the encyclopedias had references to quite older work, say by Irving Goffman, but it doesn't seem that there's a whole lot going on right now. As I say, I'm aware that I might be stepping close to a large metaphysical literature, but as philosophers of science, I think we don't need to stake out a metaphysical position to at least ask about the different possible ontologies that can inform our science and that inform our thinking, and to think about the consequences of foregrounding one kind over another. As a pluralist, I'm not really keen to make any kind of fundamentalist claim about individuals, about communities, events, actions, or interactions, but I do hope to have persuaded you that interaction is a category that merits more philosophical attention. Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. You argue for, when you say scale matters, we are arguing from a position where the focus is shifted from the individual level social epistemology, for example, to population level social epistemology. And I thought you were talking about different ways in which one could answer the same question. But then your example of disagreement, for example, made me think that perhaps what you were really trying to do was pushing for a position where different questions are being asked. Because at the individual level, you listed like a series of answers that are typically given to the question, what would justify the state of agreement of two agents that happens to be in a state of disagreement?
Mm-hmm.
And that seems to be like a question about the justification of the resolution of the disagreements.
Mm-hmm.
At the population level, you seem to answer a different question, which is what explains the reasoning process in which agents engage when they find themselves in a situation of disagreement. And there the answer is interaction, because interaction is part of a necessary or a necessary condition of a rational inquiry of science.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, there seem to be really two different questions rather than two answers to the same question. And I was wondering whether the two answers you give or could be given are really orthogonal to one another rather than one being better than the other or
So you're asking, I need to get clearer. The question that I think, all right. What's the kind of shared question? That is, what to do about disagreement, right? And what I was trying to suggest is that very question looks very different at the different scales, and it's also treated very differently, because at the individual scale, it's treated as, we might say, a first person issue. It's a first person issue, and the question is how. And it's not about the resolution of the disagreement between the two parties. It's about the resolution of a question that the other's disagreement may raise in my own mind about my own belief. So from at that scale, the issue is represented in that way. Now, yeah, so it's represented as a problem about what should I do? What does the individual do? The other party is kind of absent here. And what I was trying to suggest about the sciences, when we think about the sciences as social, as a social phenomenon, is that disagreement is part of the tissue, if you will, of the communicative structure of the sciences. And the issue isn't how do I, scientist A, deal with the fact that scientist B has come up with a different understanding or a different interpretation of the experiment. The issue is how the response is to engage in interaction. I want to know how that person got their result. I will try to explain to that person how I got my result. We'll find out one another's assumptions and so forth. So the picture seems to me a very different kind of picture. And we could then move back to the individual situation and say, well, why don't, in thinking about disagreement from the more traditional epistemological point of view, why don't we think in terms not of what the individual should do, how the individual should recalibrate her or his beliefs in the face of this new information, but rather think about how the two individuals in disagreement might kind of treat this in a collaborative way and together resolve the disagreement. So the traditional epistemology is not about resolving the disagreement, it's about how I calibrate or recalibrate my beliefs. So that's, sorry, I'm getting. So that was the kind of difference. Now, that's not to say that some of the strategies that one might use in the individual section aren't going to be applicable at the social scale, but at this, that perceived at different scales, the problem looks quite different. Looks quite different. That's all I was trying to say.
Brian?
Hi. That was really, really interesting. And as you won't be surprised, I agree with kind of a lot of the problems that you have with methodological individualism. And I wanted to just use some help understanding kind of what you see as the inadequacies of individualism when it comes to interaction in particular. As you know, I have a lot of objections to methodological individualism, but one of those are kind of based on metaphysics, where I think that lots of social facts just don't supervene on facts about individuals, so we shouldn't expect that social explanations should be able to be individualistic. Mm-hmm. But interactions is something that I have kind of stayed away from, because it seems like interactions do supervene on facts about individuals, or at least might. So the way that I was sort of trying to get clear on this was to try to understand what your perspective might be on different approaches to economics. So like in economics, historically and even today, there have been a lot of what you might call atomistic explanations in economics, where economists will model individuals as atoms that don't interact with other people at all. And they'll build models, aggregate. More recently, there have been, for quite a long time now, there have been other sorts of approaches, like game theoretic approaches, which do incorporate interactions very fundamentally into the kinds of explanations and models that people develop. And those seem to me to be, fundamentally interact, or they're at least non-atomistic. I don't know if you'd call them interactive or not. Mm-hmm. And yet, at the same time, I think of those typically as fairly methodologically individualistic. Right, because you think of a game as something that depends or supervenes on yes, interactions, but still there are mental states of individuals and decisions. It's very easy to understand how a game could be conducted and explained in terms of individuals' regard for one another and so on. So those both seem to me to be individualistic, the first being non-interactive and the second being interactive. So the kinds of examples that I've been worried about most, where I kind of think methodological individualism doesn't work, are examples where I've worried about things other than interactions, like social facts more generally. But I guess I wonder if you could be clear on why you're worried about interactions in particular, and whether those are in principle not individualistically explainable.
I'm not sure I can give a full answer. That's why I'm, you know, that's why I'm here to find out but to think about these questions, in fact. So, but I think that a reason I'm inclined to think that an interaction is in some important and interesting way different from two individual actions, for example, is that at least one of the ways of thinking about interaction, the participants in an interaction are in some way changed by that interaction in a way that they're not going to change on their own. I mean, they could change in that direction on their own, but an interaction changes individuals in a way that's different from change in state of an individual. Now, whether that whether those changes can be exhaustively accounted for by descriptions of the individual participants, I don't know. I don't know. It's a really good question, and I'd have to think about some specific examples where I think that's not the case. I mean, so one can think of, for example, the intensity we can think about. So I don't want to eliminate individuals from the thought here, but I do want to think about whether there aren't properties of an interaction that do not simply supervene on the properties of the individual participants in the interaction. So there might be things like the intensity of an interaction or other properties of the interaction qua interaction that are not reducible to properties of the individuals. But I don't know the answer to that. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, and this really wasn't meant to be a challenge, it's just to try to clarify. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the things that I thought was really interesting is the talk about resources, mm-hmm. because in as much as you want to understand interactions or the kinds of explanations you're interested in as involving things like resources or even things like institutions, that may be the kind of thing where you might actually have metaphysical reasons for thinking that individuals are not sufficient, where you might have supervenience on non-individualistic stuff. Not sure whether we would end up splitting the cases where there are strictly individual, interactive things where it doesn't involve kind of ontological dependence on the outside world, and the ones where it does.
Mm-hmm.
And the ones where it does would be, in principle, non-individualistic, but the interactions where it doesn't ontologically depend on the outside world, I'm not sure why that wouldn't be, at least potentially individualistic.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, but that's a really helpful suggestion, that we might start categorizing or classifying interactions as being of different types, and some may be reducible to some aggregation of individual traits, but some may not. And thinking about why that would be and what the conditions would be, that would be a really, I think, useful kind of thing to think about. Yeah. Thanks.
You. Yeah. Kate, thanks. Thanks for your talk. I wanted to point out what I think is, or kind of get your thoughts on what I think is an interesting disanalogy between cases, kind of everyday cases of disagreement and scientific disagreement, that might speak towards individualism for the everyday cases, but not for the scientific cases. So, in the scientific cases, scientists are working with some kind of background theory, which they can access, and then kind of have these interactive discussions on how the background theory bears on evidence and things like that. Whereas, at least this was my thought, in the everyday cases, it's not as if we're, you know, we probably are operating with some kind of background theory, but with the exception of moral cases, it might be hard for us to access or articulate that background theory. So it might be hard for us to engage in the sort of disagreement interactions that scientists are able to engage in precisely because they have this kind of theory that they can draw on explicitly. And this lack of access to a theory may speak for this kind of idealized approach in the everyday case and a less idealized approach in the scientific case. Hmm. So just, yeah, wanted to hear what you thought about that.
Yeah, well, I guess my thought is a little different, because I think it's not just what makes the scientific case different is not just, I think, the accessibility of theory. I think that actually we're dependent on a lot of theory, but theory in the everyday world doesn't vary as interestingly or as dramatically as it does in the scientific case, but I think that, you know, but that's one of the you know, you think, what kind of theory is involved in calculating a restaurant bill? it's not even that there's theory that's inaccessible.
Yeah.
So I don't think. Maybe there's, classical versus non-classical arithmetic or something you could really get esoteric about, but I don't think that that's behind the disagreement in the tip. But what I was suggesting is that, so that is an interesting difference. But what has always interested me in the disagreement literature is that you know it's treated as this kind of individual problem. It's treated as, you know, what do I do or what do you do, rather than seeing it immediately, as one might, as a social matter, where, you know, two of us disagree. What do we do? In my world, we talk to each other. And reason things out, as they say. It's not, I don't sit in my little, on my side of the table and think, well, what do I do with the information that she's come up with that different amount? No, I talk to her. I've always been puzzled by this feature of the disagreement literature. So I think you're right that there are these disanalogous situations, but I think in terms of how they get resolved, you know, thinking that I'm going to resolve this by having the right attitude about how to calibrate evidence and how to treat second order evidence and so forth, that I think is not going to be really, I mean, number one, that's not the way I'm going to do it, and I don't think it's the way most people are going to do it. I think we're going to do it much the way it's done in the scientific case, where we exchange opinions and views and think about things. So. But anyway, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm not sure that this is exactly what you wanted to talk about here, but when you were, I thought it was really interesting comparing the two cases and looking at the undetermination kind of case as a sort of bridge between the cases. But when you said that there's a kind of traditional philosopher of science view that treats science as different from ordinary epistemology because it's held to higher standards in terms of rigor and measurement, I guess I was thinking, well, probably a lot of people, at least in the public, still think that science is still supposed to be a more sort of rigorous epistemology, right? It's held to higher standards. So I guess I was just curious to hear a bit more. I'm sure you probably have formulated views about this, but do you take it that it's purely in these kind of social endeavors that one gets the higher rigor and the higher terms of objectivity, or is it also something in the traditional view that's right, that's more mathematically rigorous, more closer measurement, and that puts science as it's sort of different from everyday epistemology? Or is all the work done on the social?
No, I don't think all the work is done on the social side. I think the science is involved much more careful measurement and the rigor of mathematics, for example. And that definitely differentiates what we do in a scientific context from what we do in an everyday context. I also happen to think that greater rigor is achieved in part through the kind of critical interaction that I talk about as characteristic of the sciences. That is, that without that kind of interaction, the sciences would not have developed, scientific methods would not have developed in the ways that they have. But I don't want to say, in focusing on discursive interaction, I don't want to say that the traditional view is wrong in thinking that the sciences are differentiated from our ordinary doxastic lives through great. I'm not denying that that at all. So it's not all. It's not just interaction.
So it's more like by ignoring the social aspect, one has ignored one other source of.
Yes.
Source of.
That's right.
Yeah.
Thank you. My question also concerns the example of disagreement. So on a more social view, we could see the disagreement as an invitation to critical interactions, and we get a more dynamic and developing view of our situation. But what about the situations where we have pressure to agree on something quickly? For example, presumably in the tip calculated situation, what we want is to settle on the sum, pay, and leave.
Well, actually, in scientific context, we also may need to have a resolution of disagreement more quickly than that resolution is actually possible to achieve. So I don't think the restaurant situation differs that much. Well, it differs in its structure, and it differs in the degree of complexity that it offers. Different of these writers are going to have different views about the restaurant situation. I'm trying to think, actually, whether any of them actually says what to do in the restaurant situation. One of them says, well, let's think about the case where the disagreement, okay, so that's kind of tricky, but let's think about the case where you say 43 and your friend says 450. And, then something's gone wrong somewhere. But I don't know that any of them actually says something about that. But probably one of the recommendations would be to just take the equal weight view. When the difference is that small, and there's no reason to think that either of you have made an easily discoverable mistake, just go for 44. I mean, that would be what the equal weight view tells you to do. And in a scientific case, the stakes may be higher. So if we're thinking about trying to ascertain the acceptable levels of exposure to toxic chemicals, the difference between 44 and 45 may be considerable. So it's taking the equal weight view might be more problematic in that case, and you really want to work through the details of the disagreement before you set an exposure level. So I don't know if that gets at the what you were trying to bring to the table here, but
I wonder whether history plays some role in your view. Sense that you characterize the interaction in terms of events, social events, and the history is the domain of events. Then you make this example that in order to explain how can we explain difference in violence between Sweden and the UK. Mm-hmm. In this case, my intuitive answer is because they have different histories. So I wonder whether your claim that scale matters and interaction matters can correspond to a claim that history matters.
Of course. Yes, no, history would be involved in talking about, for example, if we're going, when we move to the population level, there's still, it's not as though issues of you know, how to explain are immediately resolved, because there are all these different possibilities. There are different kinds of population differences among populations. Physical changes, physical conditions, social conditions, and certainly history is a part of social conditions. It's a part of understanding why, for example, access to resources varies in different populations. It's a part of explaining well, there are things like age structure, which at least have a partly a historical explanation. You know, think about Japan. The age structure in Japan is now a real social problem. It's an economic problem that they have to solve. There are there are explanations for why the age distribution in Japan has become skewed towards 65 and older. So yes, history matters, and history is certainly part of it. But it's the history of what, of course, that we're still going to have to work out. Thanks.
I was just curious, because you talk about the parallel between traditional epistemology and behavioral sciences. Mm. Could you say a little bit more of, are these just independent, is the parallel just by chance, or do you think there's a deeper reason that there is this kind of bias towards individualism? And on that note, I don't know, just thinking, might an interesting case study actually be what is happening right now, what is called experimental philosophy.
Huh. Okay, I can't say anything about experimental philosophy. So, but you know, I mean, so what? I can engage in speculation about the appeal of individualism. You know, I think that there are sort of cultural psychological reasons. You know, different cultures differ in their degree of commitment to individualism. I think. I think North American culture is very deeply individualistic. I think some of that comes from our European heritage, but I think Europe, with its social democratic traditions, as recent social democratic traditions, is somewhat less individualist than the United States. But I think, you know, I think it has something to do with, I think it has something to do with us wanting to think of ourselves as mistresses or masters of our own fate. I mean, I think that's at least part of the appeal of individualism, is that, you know, I am who I am, I believe what I believe, I do what I choose to do, my choices are determined by my own deliberation about the values and the benefits and disvalues. So I think that kind of has a lot to do with it. There are other cultures where the individual feels her or himself much more closely engaged with the community of which she or he is a member, where individualism is just not as much a feature of culture. But that's about as far as I can go.
Okay, last question, Christina.
Yeah, thank you. I just want to continue something that Jana already brought up about kind of like special cases where science, where people have to agree fast, uh-huh. and where the sort of social interaction model of how scientific knowledge is produced may not always be that accurate. So I think another interesting case is the case of meta-analysis. you know, it's a kind of like a shortcut, you know, it's a way of just trying to arrive as a synthesis of the field with aggregation of the individual side. Not really bringing people into interaction, but just aggregating the views.
But waiting.
What do you think about that?
What do I think about meta-analysis?
Yeah, and how do they better the social interaction? Is it somehow like less objective or pseudo-objective or?
Well, I mean, meta-analysis is just a, what do I want to say? It's like the studies that are the food for meta-analysis, garbage in, garbage out. I mean, the meta-analysis is only as good as the selection process that determines which studies are going to be included in the meta-analysis, and I think that that's really where all the meat of meta-analysis resides. Yes, it is a way to try to quickly come up with some kind of synthetic some synthesis of a multiplicity of studies with slightly varying, even greatly varying results. But I'm quite influenced by one of the statisticians at Stanford, John Ioannidis, who is very dubious about both statistics and there's actually a really nice paper by what's his first name? Surname is Stegenga. On meta-analysis as well. So there's some really good critical work on, philosophically critical work on meta-analysis. But meta-analysis is, in a way, what I would say is it's just like any kind of statistical analysis in that sense. You know, you present a meta-analysis and it immediately is food for, it doesn't stop critical interaction, it just becomes another a topic for critical interaction. And, you know, the issue of questions that need quick resolution. I just want to say one thing about that. It doesn't show that kind of critical discursive interaction is unnecessary. In fact, if what we're after is, you know, kind of the best, most accurate representation, etc., you know, these problematic, then critical interaction is necessary, but critical interaction is often going to take a lot longer than the time we have to provide an answer on the basis of which to take action. And that's a problem about which I don't have an answer. Things like meta-analysis are supposed to, you know, get us somewhere, but they're not actually getting us closer to the truth, they're just getting us closer to, you know, a resolution that may or may not be a good basis on which to act. I think that depends a lot on
discovery and analysis. Okay, I think we can stop here.
Well, thank you. Thank you.